Hey guys, John Rocket TV One here. What's up?
Okay, so what better to work on my cheap Chinese e-bike controllers than my cheap Chinese soldering station? Yeah, it's a Zenny 862 Plus, and if you want to see that video, it'll be over here. So, what do we mean when we are talking about the shunt mod on these e-bike controllers, and what does it actually do? Well, I'm going to show you right now what it actually means. This is a blown controller that is probably repairable with a couple of the through-hole devices that go on here. And this is a 48-volt controller. And it probably, with a very small modification, would be a 36-volt controller. How do I know? Well, because my bicycle is 36-volt and it has the exact same board. So they, with small modifications, can be made to run with a 48-volt battery, which could be in the neighborhood of 50-plus volts, 52, 53, hot off the charger, which means that if there are any devices like these capacitors on this board here that are only specced out at 50 volts, well, that's a problem. So you should probably have 60 or 63 volt caps on this, but that's for another video. We'll talk about that later. Okay, so what everybody's concerned about here with this video is the shunt. And what does the shunt do, and what is it about? Well, the shunt is basically just a resistance wire or resistance alloy that is of a known resistance and was engineered to work with the board to provide not a specific current, but a specific resistance to whatever it is seeing coming from your battery. And that being said, what it amounts to is that for whatever your battery is putting out when it's hot off the charger and during its use, what you're using out of it, there is a direct relationship to what the battery voltage is as to what the board is capable of putting out. And that is determined by the resistance of this wire. Now, this is a 9-FET 48-volt controller, and it is specced up to 23 or 22 amp plus or minus one, they call them, output, which of course we'll go into more depth in that in a later video. But what the shunt is doing is it is providing an amount of current and voltage across its distance to the rest of the circuitry in the board, and that is being proportional to what is coming out of the battery. And so it is then being sending its proportional amount of voltage to the controller, which then of course sends it to the FETs, which end up in your phase wires, which ends up in your motor. And so by lowering the resistance in the shunt, the amount of voltage is thereby, and amperage is thereby, increased by an amount, and that is then the signal that allows the rest of the microcontroller to go ahead and send that proportional amount of voltage out to your motor. Okay, so that is in basics what the shunt is doing. It is basically sort of a measuring device. It's not doing the measuring itself. The measuring is built into the thickness of the wire and the length of it and how many of them are on your board. And so, a bit of a problem with these controllers are there are parts of these that are, of course, machine mounted. You know, most of the SMD devices are going to be placed by a machine. However, the FETs and a lot of the soldering back here on the back side of the board is going to be done by hand. And you probably aren't going to be able to see this really too well here on the video. But you will be able to see this if you look at your board under a microscope or even with a high-powered magnifier. You will see that some guys here on the internet, YouTube and Google and all, they talk about beefing up the traces. And well, that is because you know, these solder traces are probably near at their limit of current carrying capabilities by the copper that's built into the board. And that's, you know, one of the problems that comes along with making them smaller. And, of course, the smaller they get, the more problematic this current capability, carrying capability, becomes. And I could, you know, liken this to the fact that, you know, why are the welding cables so heavy? Well, you know, welding cables and jumper cables, or that's probably even better. Maybe if you've ever had to jump start your car before, you will realize that the tiny little jumper cables that you can buy at 7-Eleven are nowhere near what the kind of capability, you know, jumper cables that you can get at your auto parts place that are much heavier wire. The much heavier wire is going to take and bring that battery capacity to your car so that you can go ahead and get it started. So the heavier the wire, the more power you can get through it without melting. That said, here on the internet, you will see that guys are called, they, you know, beefing up the traces. And so, beyond the fact that if you realize that these boards are probably made for under $10, with most of the surface mount stuff, the FETs are the high powered carrying current devices on this. Excuse me. Next to the capacitors. And that being said, guys are taking, and even here from the factory, if you look closely on these boards, you will see that there is definitely wire buried in the solder traces on this board, meaning that they probably took some 14 gauge or 16 gauge copper wire, solid copper wire, and buried it in the trace here on the board. And that is where the extra current carrying capability comes in. However, if you look really close, this happens to be the positive rail on this board. This one here is the negative rail on this board. And if you look, and be careful if you do this stuff, because it is very small. So you're going to need a soldering iron that's capable. And you're going to have to be able to do this accurately, or you will definitely plug in your board and smoke it. And letting the magic smoke out of this board is likely means that you will be looking for one. And buying a generic one of these is not as easy as it looks, just plugging tight colors together, because the manufacturers don't all go with, standard black and red and black and red and green. They just don't do it, which is unfortunate, but guess what? So I'm going to just point this stuff out here a little bit. You're probably not going to be able to see this too good here on the video. I do my best to zoom this stuff in for you. Okay. So, while you could see the wire is buried in these main traces here on the board, you could see that where the legs connect to the MOSFETs, there's big gaps. And those gaps are where, even though I got proper current carrying capabilities right here, only a 16th of an inch away where the leg mounts to the board, there's no solder there. So there's a big gap. So while I am getting voltage maybe down here to the one that's connected a little better, the one that's on this end over here is going to be something less. And that's problematic, because when I say something less, microvolts and microamps difference between the FETs means that one's working harder than the other, and or more efficient than the other. And of course, one of the phases in your motor, whichever one happens to be connected to the problem soldering job, is the one that's going to not be producing, and thereby your motor is less efficient. So I guess what this is really about is the modification to the shunt is something that you can do. That what I'm going to liken this to, okay, because here's two, and you're probably not going to be able to see all what I've got as far as the big difference is. However, if you was to take your vernier micrometer and measure these, and then add a little bit of solder to both the pads and these, I'm not recommending blobbing this up and connecting it, because at that point you could very well be changing that value, the resistance value, by 50%, which is not good. I'm recommending that what you're trying to do is fix improper solder and maybe cold solder joints on the board, and staying within the engineering, what was engineered into the thing from the beginning. and that, and what this whole device was able to do, had it all been put together with by somebody that, that was trying to make something work, you know, absolutely perfect. Just because it met QC on the bench over there in China somewhere for 35 seconds, or however, probably less than that, is not going to be very good for you if you end up on a hill with your e-bicycle and you're not powerful enough to go ahead and get started without using full throttle. That's why a lot of these burn. These particular boards here were actually, one was shorted from water ingress, and the other one, because Mrs. Vehicle Owner drove it off a trail into a tree and smashed the display, shorting out the display voltage, which then took out the input side of the board here. That said, it's you know, I don't need to really show you the soldering iron, me doing this, but what we're trying to do is correct poor soldering on the board, and nothing more than 10% additional diameter and connection points to the board here. On both sides of the board, that these solder joints are all good, and everywhere else on the board, okay, everywhere else on the board is a proper solder joint, and just by doing that, you will be increasing the efficiency of your controller, and probably getting yourself 10 to 15% more torque and speed. If your machine is not speed limited by the display, you know, the UK and Canada, they got, you know, every country seems to have different standards about, you know, how fast they want you going on the roads. And so you guys, it will be determined by the display and possibly the controller. If it's not, however, getting a little bit more torque out of it, out of the hole when you're leaving a stoplight or something like that, is what this is really all about. A little bit of reading on this sort of thing and proper soldering techniques, if you could practice on something else, that'd be good. Making sure that your heat sink is flat back here and that all of these screws are in good condition and locked down properly, that this is flat and you use some heat paste across the back when you put it back into your box. There are no burrs for these screws hanging out of your box, and you will definitely be doing the work that was not done at the factory, because hey, they're trying to give these things away for around the $20, and if you have proper IRF and not Chinese branded FETs, you know, this you know, on this nine FET thing, there's $20 worth of FETs in there, unless you're buying them by the hundreds, and so that's a decent FET, the 3077, and you're just, what we're talking about here is doing the work that did not get done on the bench over in China when they built this thing. Filling in the gaps, making sure everything is, there's no cold solder joints. You know, even on some of this, they pump these out of here so fast that a lot of the solder joints are poor. I didn't see any, what do you call, Rojas sticker on here, so, but I am going to imagine that it's no lead solder, and using proper 6040 or a 6337 solder on there is going to be much better for the efficiency of this device. So thanks for watching, you guys. Like I said, we got some more of these videos coming for you. As far as the machining and stuff videos, don't forget, hey, I'm a variety channel around here, and we're trying to mix it up for you a little bit, so you guys can get to, you know, hey, understand the variety. Thanks for watching, you guys. You guys like this video, please sub, hit the thumbs up, hit the bell, so that you guys can get these videos. Thanks for watching. John Rocket TV1 said that.